Hey there, loyal followers of Crap TV. We're starting the show a bit different tonight. We wanted to let you know that we would usually be back here in 2 weeks with another wonderful show for you, but we're changing up the schedule a bit instead. Instead of coming back to you on the 25th of March, our next show will be on April 1st, okay? No, this is not an April Fool's joke. This is real. The reason for this is we'll be out of town working on a very special project, which is what tonight's show is dedicated to. We're going to dedicate the show to this special project, and we're going to show you a short video about exactly what we're up to. Enjoy the video, and then we'll come back with the show.
I'm Ron McCoy, and I run recording studios in North Hollywood, California. I got into music when I was very young. When I was about 11, I started singing with a girl named Peggy. And Peggy and I, Peggy was not my sister, but we became a brother-sister act. Eventually got signed by RCA, wound up in Nashville when I was 14 years old, and recorded with Chet Atkins as producer. Buddy Harmon was on drums, Hank Garland on guitar, Floyd Kramer was playing the piano, and then we wound up being on some really major shows. The Grand Ole Opry, Louisiana Hayride, traveled with Johnny Horton when he was on tour. Kids wind up not being able to keep themselves together, and we eventually broke up when I was probably maybe 16. And then I got out of music for a little bit. The thing that's amazing is when I was actually 17, my father wanted to keep me in the music, so he bought me what I wanted, which was a Birdland guitar. And it was terrific. This was 1960, so I was probably 17. Well, the guitar was a blonde guitar, and it was a beautiful semi-acoustic guitar, but it has my name in the neck, Ronnie McCoy, in Mother of Pearl. In 75, whenever I started to go to California one night, I was traveling with my family, and we stopped outside of El Paso, and it turned out that we got hit by a bolt cutter. The guitar got taken, and I have not seen the guitar for 45 years. I was a disc jockey for 17 years. Got myself a job in a small radio station in Long Beach.
Remember, the Downins is your local Mako. This is Ronnie McCoy, and it's time for some roundabout from Yes.
And I was there just as new owners came in and were about to change the format, and they let me take it to a freeform format, which, as you probably know, meant that we could probably play pretty much anything we wanted. So I got involved with Blue Oyster Cult because I liked them a lot, and they weren't quite broken as a band yet. They hadn't really broken. We were the ones that actually were the first ones to play Blue Oyster Cult and were held responsible for their becoming a big band. Technically, I was also the first one to play Supertramp. The thing was that I had an import show where I play import music from different countries, and I had gotten an advanced copy, started playing it, and first thing I know, I get a call from A&M Records, calls me up and says, hey, you can't play that record, you know, and obviously what it was doing is pissing off the other radio stations in town because they didn't have the album, and I did, and I said, wow, this sounds like radio to me, and I continued to play it like crazy. I know there are a number of other people that looked. I didn't have much faith that I'd ever find it. I mean, I had certainly had thoughts about doing it, but I hadn't. But I've had people that have searched for the guitar online and couldn't find it. Bill Holmes came to me and said, I think we found it. And he says, my daughter-in-law's found it back here. You know, it's coming. Well, look, you know, I go and look, and sure enough, when I see it online, I am just so dumbfounded, I can't believe that it's still in existence. There are a few things in my life that I would hawk the house for, but this is the thing that I would hawk the house for. And that is because my father had it made for me, and it was very, very special, and it's a wonderful guitar in the first place, but it's just a wonderful piece of my father as far as I'm concerned. He didn't play guitar, but he supported my musical career. You know, I've thought about the guitar for the last 45 years, and of course, having it come home seems like a really amazing thing. But I'm thinking the guitar over those years must have been through many, many travels and stories. And since then, I've been through many, many travels and stories. And I can hardly wait to get back with the guitar and put my stories with her stories and see what kind of music comes out.
From the Crap TV studios in beautiful North Hollywood, California, comes the new game show that's sweeping the nation, North Hollywood Cubes, with special guest stars, Bruce Thomas, Jenny Curtis, Chuck Klausmeier, boy genius Greg Kufera, Allie Dixon, there she is, Kyle Holmes, Andy Lerner, Gary Anthony Williams, and Steve Rudnick in the center cube.
One of these stars is sitting in the mystery cube, and the contestant that picks it first could win a prize that just happens to be sitting on a shelf somewhere here at the Crap TV studios. And here's the master of North Hollywood Cubes, Mr. Bill Holmes.
Hey, everybody! Boom! Yeah! Yeah!
How about that video? Look at it. Hey, thanks. Thanks, Bill. Hello, everyone, and welcome to North Hollywood Cubes. Listen, everybody, thanks for watching our little video. There's a link to the GoFundMe campaign in the description of tonight's show. We hope you can donate and share with your friends, etc., all that stuff. You can also go to craptv.online and find the link there, too, okay? Thank you very much for indulging us, and we're hoping to get that, that money raised. We're going to make a documentary about it. Hello, stars! Hello, stars! Hello. There they are. There they are. Where? There they are. Look at that. Oh, it's great to see you all here tonight. Hey, now let's not forget that tonight's show is live, so anything can happen, and it usually does. We want to remind you of our new website, craptv.online. There you can find all of our social media accounts, as well as chat while you're on the show and all that fun stuff. Choose any platform you would like to watch the show on, or just watch it right here on the site itself, craptv.online. Okay. Again, thank you all so much for being here. Thank you, stars, for being here. Let's get right to it and welcome our first contestant. He comes all the way from us from down the street at Audio Rents, Vito Vascuzzo. Vito! Vito! Hey, Vito, it's good to see you, Vito. Vito, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm originally from Indianapolis, Indiana. Been in Los Angeles for a really long time, an actor turned baker, but I currently work for the audio company.
Well, welcome. Welcome to the show. Thanks for playing the game tonight. Let's get to our next contestant from somewhere else in the United States. I'm told she's from Erie, Pennsylvania. Devin Yates, everybody. Devin Yates.
Hello, hello.
Hey, Devin, how you doing? Tell us a little bit about yourself, Devin.
Well, I recently moved back to Erie. I lived in New York for 10 years, and COVID kind of shifted my plans in life. So
COVID.
I am in Erie, Pennsylvania, but happy because it's the first time since I was like 18 years old that I've been consistently around my family, which has been super nice. So.
Oh, that's great. Fantastic. That's good. Yeah. Good that you're having a good time with the family. All right. Well, we know our contestants. Let's get started with the game. Let me tell you a little bit about that. The object of the players is to get three cubes in a row, across, up or down, or diagonally. Now, it's up to them to figure out whether the stars are giving a correct answer or just making one up. That's how they earn the cube, with either a kiss or a hug. Each completed game is worth $2.50. The player that wins the most cash at the end of two or three rounds will win the grand prize of the evening. Here's the grand prize, everybody. A check for $50 from my brother, Scott Holmes, at Scott Holmes Cabinetry in Antioch, Illinois. Scott Holmes Cabinetry, he's got money to burn. Yes, indeed. All right, now, we used to give away, a Carcerum t-shirt at the end of the show. We can't do that anymore because we figured you want cash instead. So if you want to get your own Carcerum merch, what do we got for them, Bill?
The Carcerum branded merchandise t-shirt is just one of many Carcerum branded merchandise items. The only official merchandise of Carcerum, the award-winning fantasy podcast series that's taking the nation by storm. Select from a wide array of t-shirts, hoodies, coffee cups, and much, much more. That's Carcerum branded merchandise, Carcerum fantasy podcast series. Subscribe today.
All right, it's all about the merch, everybody. It's all about the merch. Download Carcerum today if you haven't. We have 130,000 downloads so far, okay? Now, contestants will also be playing for a mystery cube. If they happen to pick the mystery cube during the game, they will hear this sound. And I hope they hear it because I usually forget about it. Okay, and they could win another fabulous prize. Bill, tell them what they could win.
Bill, if our contestant picks the mystery cube, they'll also be playing for a Mugshot's Voiceover Dr. Blobbity Blah coffee mug. This mug not only holds coffee, but it holds all kinds of liquids. You can drink any of those liquids, including coffee, from the Voiceover Dr. Blobbity Blah coffee mug. Hold it in your hand or set it on a table in between sips. You'll always enjoy a hot cup of joe with your Voiceover Dr. Blobbity Blah coffee mug.
All right, technology forbids us from showing our home audience the mystery cube, so it will remain a mystery until one of our contestants picks it. The contestant that wins the mystery cube round must come to the studio and pick it up at their convenience, as we cannot afford the postage, okay? All right, so, okay, contestants, let's get started. We flipped a coin, and Hugs won, so they get to start the game. So that's Vito, right? Vito?
Yes.
Yep. Where's Vito? Where's Vito? Where is he? Where's Vito?
Right
oh,
here.
Hey, there
right
he is,
here.
Vito.
There I am.
All right, Vito, you get to pick a cube. Who would you like to start with, Vito?
Well, I think I got to go with Steve.
Steve Ooh. Rudnick. Steve Rudnick, ladies and gentlemen, big-time writer, comedian, the Santa Claus, and the Space Jam that everybody likes, okay? All right, Steve. Steve. Have the edibles kicked in yet, Steve? No, you're muted. You're muted. Unmute.
Okay, I'm muted. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes. Have the edibles kicked in?
Yeah. No, I'll give you the signal when they do, remember.
That's the signal. Okay, all right. Here we go. I was thinking with you being muted, maybe they kicked in already.
No,
okay.
No. The right, answer,
Steve.
Bill, is the
no,
answer,
wait, Steve,
Bill.
No, I haven't asked a question. I didn't ask a question yet. Here we go.
Oh, you know what? I think they just kicked in.
Okay. Vito, listen up here, Vito. When, hey, Steve, what came first, a man on the moon or wheels on suitcases?
Oh, good question. Okay. We're going to figure this out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Man on the moon was what, 1969. Okay.
69, I believe.
1969, were there wheels on? You know, 1960s, the big problem with luggage, there was gorillas, if you remember correctly.
I do. Oh.
The big luggage, big luggage. They would take these big suitcases and throw them in gorilla cages.
Yeah.
And the Samsonite big luggage, and that was it.
Yeah.
I don't remember wheels.
So did they put wheels on them after that experience?
I think what happened was big luggage said, boy, okay, they're stronger than a gorilla, but they're heavy as hell.
Yeah.
And then someone thought of putting wheels on. But I think that was after they landed on the moon.
Okay.
What was the question then?
So what came first, a man on the moon or wheels on a suitcase?
I'll tell you a funny story after.
Okay.
Man on the moon came before.
Man on the moon. Okay, Vito. He says a man on the moon came first. You agree or disagree?
I am going to agree with that.
That is correct. The man on the moon came before. Can you believe that? They put a man on the moon before they said, hey, you know, if we put wheels on this fucking thing, it would be a lot easier to roll around.
So you got the
hug there. Steve, did you have a story?
Well, the story, I don't know if I told it before, but it was when we were limousine drivers. Bill and I used to drive limousines in Chicago, and one of my clients was Neil Armstrong, because Eastern Airlines used to be. So I pick up Neil Armstrong, and one of my biggest regrets in my life is I didn't say these things I so wanted to say. So I opened the door, and I wanted to say, watch that first step, Mr. Armstrong, but I didn't say that.
Yeah.
And then we're in the cab and we're driving and he says, hey, excuse me, how do you turn the TV on? And I was going to say, you know, they could put a man on the moon, but they can't make a TV.
Yeah.
And I didn't say that either. So.
Okay. Well, there you had your chance, didn't you,
That's
Steve?
My Neil Armstrong 5 minutes.
Okay. Well, let's go over to Devin here. Devin?
Yes. Devin? Hello.
Who would you like to go with, Devin?
I got to go with Bruce because that's my dad's name.
Bruce Thomas, nice. Ladies and gentlemen. Oh, Bruce Thomas. Bruce is on all the video games. He was in Legally Blonde.
All of them.
You're in every video game ever made.
Oh, my God. You're the UPS guy from Legally Blonde.
He's the UPS guy from Legally Blonde. That's right.
I know. Still great.
And you know what, Devin? When I met him, I did the same thing. I'm like, oh, you're the UPS guy. Okay. Oh, look at this. Look at this. We have a Legally Blonde question. Bruce, here's your first question. You ready?
You dug deep.
I didn't know a lot about you, babe. Okay. What are you drinking? What are you drinking, Bruce?
I'm drinking a little Stolish Naya, which is, I guess, taboo right now, right about now.
Yeah, it's
kind of... Get rid of it.
But they're changing their name to Stoli, so that helps, I guess.
Okay,
Stoli with a splash of grapefruit.
Okay. All right. Be careful. That could hurt you with your cholesterol pills.
Oh.
Okay. All right.
Didn't know that.
In the film Legally Blonde, who played your character's love interest? Who played your character's love interest? A lot of
oh my god, that's you are really digging deep on this one.
Yeah.
Oh my god, that's so easy.
I know.
Well, then get it.
It
right.
Was 20 years ago, so I do have to think about this one a minute.
Maybe there was somebody who didn't see the movie. I don't know.
20 years ago. Let's see. They are writing a new one, by the way. They're writing a Legally Blonde 3. It's called Legally Gray.
Oh,
really?
Are you gonna run the UPS store now?
I don't know. I haven't been invited.
Oh man.
This is an easy one. If anybody's ever seen the film, they obviously know that I fell in love with Reese Witherspoon. I mean, she's the star of the movie.
Right. I mean, that makes sense. So he says, Devin, he says Reese Witherspoon. Do you agree or disagree?
That's so false.
Okay. She disagrees with you, Bruce. She disagrees with you, and that is correct. It was, of course, it was Jennifer Coolidge.
Oh, you meant the character.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Come on.
I didn't realize you were saying personally you fell in love with Reese.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood.
Okay, no, that's all right. But she does get the kiss over there. And
hey, Bruce, Bill, just yes, a quick kudos to Bruce there, who in protest of the war is getting rid of all his Russian vodka. Good for you, Bruce.
Yeah.
And patriots, I salute you.
If I may, in honor of that, Bruce, I'm offering you a part in the new Legally Blonde.
Fantastic. Thank you, Gary.
You're welcome.
No one really knows this. We've kept this a secret for a long time. Gary runs show business.
I run show. No. Gary runs show business.
Big difference.
Okay. Ain't got time for the S in the middle.
Sorry, I gave it the white
pronunciation. Yeah.
I thank you, and my landlord thanks you.
You're welcome.
All right. Well, we're going back to Vito. Where the hell is Vito? Vito's over here. Okay, yeah. Vito, who do you pick now? The game's pretty early.
There's a lot of great choices, but I'm going to go with the genius, Greg. The boy
Greg
genius.
Greg Kufera, boy genius. Greg Kufera, boy genius. Here we go, Greg. Are you ready?
Oh, yeah.
Greg's got a startup, and he was an advisor on Silicon Valley. And listen, kids, you can see Greg. He's like the sand guy in which one? In the one?
On the Mandalorian.
The Mandalorian. He's one of those sand.
Yeah. I can make the noise too.
We all know exactly what that is.
Yeah. I know, right? Yeah. Okay, Greg.
We need any more explanation.
Greg, here's a smart guy question. Here's a smart guy question, okay? Okay, Greg, can you comb a hairy ball flat without creating a cowlick?
What? That's a good
question. Can you comb a hairy ball flat without creating a cowlick?
This is a surprising question.
No, it's not.
But this is also a fundamental question in the field of algebraic topology.
Okay.
What? It turns out, yeah, what a surprise. He's and it turns out that coincidentally,
it's a math problem.
I was a math major at Princeton.
Go ahead.
And go ahead. But this was truly one of my favorite theorems. It's called the hairy ball theorem.
Uh-oh.
Answer is that
okay,
no,
you're back. You're back
for a second.
You're back. It was called the hairy ball theorem.
Yeah, so the hairy ball theorem says that if you have a ball that's completely covered in hair, like a koosh ball, or like a man's head that where something is seriously wrong, sure, you need at least one cowlick. You can't have a completely smooth head. And you know what else that means? Is that on Earth, the wind has to be still at least one location. And so this was proved by Henri Poincaré in the 1800s, who's also known as the father of algebraic topology.
Yep. And, he was the father of the windless day.
No, Andy, you're mistaken. He was the father of the hairy ball.
Yeah, this is why I love having this kid on the show.
He had two hairy balls, even.
Okay, so Greg, can you comb a hairy ball flat without creating a cowlick? Yes or no?
So the answer is no. You always have to have at least one.
Okay. All right, Vito, he says no. Do you know anything about the hairy ball theorem?
According to the top of my head, no. I know nothing about
it. So do you agree with him that it's no, or do you disagree?
He said that, you have to have at least one. I agree with
he
that.
He said no. You agree
he
with
said no?
Greg?
Then I disagree. I think you have to have one.
You disagree. Okay. Well, you would be incorrect. You would be incorrect, Vito. I mean, the guy's a damn physicist here. Why the hell would you disagree with this kid, right?
What?
Okay.
Wait.
What?
Yeah, you have to have at least one.
Yeah, Bill.
Which is what I said, too. So.
Oh, is that is what you said?
Yeah, that's why I agreed with him originally.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. All right. So it's correct. So you got it correct. Okay. So you win. You win. You win the damn hug or whatever.
Thank God Bill's in charge.
Okay. All right. You know. The kid calls me up. The kid calls me up and he goes, "Hey, Bill, I want to talk about hairy balls." I didn't know it was going to be this. You know. Okay. All right. All right. So. So we got some strategy here. We got some strategy here, Devin. What do you want to do, Devin? What do you want to do here?
I want to go with Allie.
Allie Dixon. Star of The Croods. You can see that on what? Hulu? Is that on Hulu, Allie?
Hulu and Peacock.
She plays Eep.
You can
Eep?
Right next to Harry Ball. It's the channel right next to
really? The Peacock and the Harry Ball?
No wonder I have trouble finding it.
I'm sure Harry you Ball do, Network Chuck. I've seen you in a hot tub. Okay. All right. So Allie.
Never
Allie,
speak of that again.
Allie's on the big time TV show The Croods. Okay, so Allie, here's kind of a cartoon question for you. What Hollywood production company produced The Flintstones? Flintstones?
That is a show about cavemen that is not the show I'm on.
Yes, it is. The original Thank caveman
you.
Show.
Thank you for that. Yeah. Interesting. Yes, I am not someone who knows these kinds of facts.
Okay.
Typically, I like Bill makes a reference every 10 seconds to somebody from the 60s, and there I'm always just silent. I just don't.
I would think you would know.
But because I've been hanging around Bill Holmes enough,
okay,
I'm pretty sure, like 80% sure, mm-hmm, it was Hanna-Barbera.
Hanna-Barbera.
Because it was a play on words, and I thought it was kind of stupid.
Hanna-Barbera. Okay.
Hanna-Barbera?
Hanna-Barbera. She said
Hanna-Barbera. Hanna favorite of the Barbera trio.
So now, Devin.
She was arrested by Matlock.
Answer this carefully, Devin.
Do you agree with Hanna-Barbera? Right now, because the look in her eyes when she first got the question was like, what? The actual? And then she's like, okay, how can I get my way out of this? So,
but like, how good of an actor am I?
You agree or disagree?
Super great actor.
Yeah, the Oscars are only in a couple of weeks. You might be late.
I don't believe you. I'm really sorry, Allie.
So you're disagreeing with Hanna-Barbera, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, you are correct. It is Hanna-Barbera. Hanna-Barbera. Okay, so you're correct. So you win.
Close.
You win the kiss. You win the kiss. That's a good thing. It's all good.
I win the kiss.
Hey, Bill,
all right.
Fact about the Flintstones. Flintstones are in the news right now. They're banned in Florida because they're having a gay old time.
We'll have a gay old time. Yeah, that's true. Good one, Andy. Okay. All right, let's go over to who we got. Vito, who the hell do you want to go with here now?
Well, you know, I'm gonna move right up from Allie to Chuck.
Yes! Chuck Klausmeier.
Come on, Chuck.
Oh, you made Chuck's night.
Do it.
Chuck Klausmeier. You're so excited, Chuck, to be picked.
Yeah, I am. I got called on.
Okay. All right, Chuck, here you go, Chuck. You work with Mike Rowe all the time. You're into statistics and everything and science, uh-huh, and stuff. So, Chuck, is true or false, a cloud can weigh up to 1 million pounds. A fluffy cloud. Can it weigh up to 1 million pounds?
Well, I mean, I suppose it's possible, but it's very difficult to get it on the scale. How would you know? I mean,
I would think so. Yeah.
How could it? Of course, yes. Of course, it could.
1 million pounds. So he says yes.
Sure.
All right. So Vito, he says yes. Do you agree or disagree?
Well, this is where I really wish the boy genius would pipe in, the mathematic wizard. But I don't think it's going to happen. So I'm going to say yes. Yes, it can weigh up.
He says yes. You agree. So that is correct. And just so you know, Vito, the boy genius sent me that question. So there you go.
So there you go. Google.
All right, so you got your hug there.
So
let me see the board. So, Devin, again, strategy needs to kick in. Who do you want to go with?
I'm going to go with Kyle because I got to.
Holmes, my boy. Kyle.
The only reason anyone went with him in high school, especially.
I'm counting on you, Kyle. I'm counting on you.
He was forced into it, Kyle. Live with that.
I only got dates to dances out of necessity.
Okay, so Kyle Holmes is my son.
Bill, before you go on, this battle is Ali Frazier. This is this is fantastic.
One for the ages, isn't it, Steve?
I mean, the defense, the offense, it's incredible. Go on, Bill.
And Steve knows.
The signal.
Steve knows. He's a regular on the show. He's
he
a
forgot
regular
the signal.
No, this was 10 minutes ago.
Oh.
Okay, Kyle Holmes.
Yes.
Kyle Holmes, he's a financial advisor. He's a baseball. Oh, hey, wait a minute. What is Allie doing there? What's Allie? No, Allie, get out of there. This is Kyle's question. Get out of there.
I don't
want
to know that.
Okay. All right, Kyle, he's a baseball enthusiast and he's a father to my grandson, Will. Okay, here we go, Kyle.
I hope so.
Listen up, Kyle. Listen up. Here we go.
Come on. Yeah.
What do you mean? What do you mean? No, Shane, get out of there.
Get
out of there. It's Kyle's turn to talk. Okay.
Still right. Admitting that you're his father. Impressive.
Okay. Devin, listen to this now. Okay. Tavern owner William Cianis was stopped at the gate before game four of the 1945 World Series at Wrigley Field, and they refused him entry. Why, Kyle? Why did they refuse him entry to game four of the 1945 World Series with the Chicago Cubs?
What was his name again?
His name was William Cianis.
Okay.
This is a tough one, Bill, because a lot of people today would look at you and they would tell you they refused him entry because he refused to wear his mask. That's
No.
That's 1945. But since I am a Chicago Cubs expert,
absolutely,
self-proclaimed, of course,
yes,
Chicago Cubs expert, I am well aware of the fact that he was refused entry because of his pet goat.
Because
what?
Of his
pet goat. And thus is the goat. Curse of the goat that was broken in 2016 when the Cubs slaughtered a goat in the clubhouse and drank its blood in order to win the World Series.
I did not know. Was that during the rain delay?
That was during the rain delay. Yeah,
blood
John Lester.
World Series champs. I forgot about them.
2016 okay. World Series champs. Last person to win a world, last team to win a legitimate World Series in baseball. They drank the blood of a goat in the clubhouse because in 1945, a tavern owner was refused entry with his pet goat. 100%.
Okay, so Devin, he says because he wanted
story,
he says,
Kyle, what a story.
He says 100% because he wanted to bring in his pet goat.
I am right, Devin. 100%.
Do I feel like that's just, I don't know, man.
Which part of that story is hard to believe, Devin?
I mean, literally so much of it.
Focus in on the goat.
Well, oh my God. The thing is he's a Cubs fan, but didn't he? Oh, okay, hold on.
Goat had COVID.
Power of deduction.
Yeah. Goat wouldn't wear a mask.
Toddler.
Again, Devin, he's saying because he wanted to bring in his pet goat and they refused
Devin,
him entry.
He was real cocky with that 100% thing.
Yeah. 100%.
That sounded real cocky.
Pet goat. The drinking
world
of the
drinking
goat
world life. Champions.
All right, we need
that.
An answer.
I'm gonna say you know what, Kyle? I'm gonna give you the benefit of the doubt.
Ugh.
And I'm gonna say that this is true. And I am probably gonna kick myself for it, but I'm gonna do it anyway because I liked your conviction. So
Devin, it is true. It is true. William Cianis owned Billy Goat's Tavern in Chicago, and he wanted to bring his goat in, and they wouldn't let him. And he put a curse on the Cubs, and they didn't win a World Series until 2016.
Can we verify the blood drinking in the locker room? Is that
actually, Andy, that's
funny story about that. John Lester only drank the blood of the goat out of a Bud Light can. That was his Bud Light.
Everyone knows that
blood
about
light.
Okay,
a
so
blood light.
So
blood
we got the kiss.
Can.
We got the kiss going there on that cube.
Bill,
sure, Steve.
One thing about the Cubs beating that curse is the golden two or three weeks of the 21st century. If you think about it, the Cubs had just won the World Series.
Yeah.
And in a few weeks, Hillary was going to be president. There's that small time in there, and then the election happened. So if you've ever met those,
yes. All was right in the world.
We go to Vito.
Yes. Vito.
Yes.
Okay. Who do you got? Steve's right. This is like Ali Frazier. What do you got now? If we don't get in a row, the first one to five cubes is going to be the winner. So Vito, where do you want to go this time?
I'm going to go with Jenny. I got a good feeling about Jenny.
Jenny Curtis, ladies and gentlemen. Jenny Curtis is producing the show Solar. It's an audio drama series. It's really great. She's got some big
Is that the
people.
One where people stare at the sun and die?
Stare at the sun, that's right.
That's exactly
we
what
got, yeah. We got Helen Hunt.
Spoilers, though. You just gave away the whole show.
Helen Hunt, Alan Cumming. A lot of great stars in it. Okay, Jenny. Here we go, Jenny. Here we go, Jenny. You ready? How many
Let's
planets?
Go, Jenny.
Jenny? Allie. Allie. Get out of there, Allie. Get out of there,
get
Allie.
Get out of there.
Okay. All right,
I
Jenny.
Needed her as my cheat sheet.
Are you ready, Jenny? Are you ready? Where the hell did Jenny go? Here we go.
I'm here. I'm just
Jenny, no. How many planets in our solar system? How many planets are in our solar system?
Oh, that's a good question. Good
Look,
question.
This is it's a really hot button topic. Uh-huh. Because I will tell you, I'm gonna say there are nine. But what I've been told from scientific sources, a la NASA, and who's going to believe them, I don't really know, is that some people believe Pluto's not a planet. Okay. Now, I disagree wholeheartedly.
Okay.
But I think the overall answer is there are eight planets. I'm going to say nine. I've also petitioned for the sun to be a planet. So if you'll all sign it, we're going for 10. Okay. Wow.
All right. So saying nine. She's saying nine, Vito. What do you say? You agree?
Well, you know, the Pluto thing, I grew up with Pluto being a planet, and I really appreciate it being a planet, and I really hated when they said it's not a planet anymore. But I'm going to disagree. I'm going to go with what the scientists are saying nowadays, that there are eight.
There are eight. So you disagree. Yes. I need to, do we have a judge on this? Because I have eight. Nine if you include Pluto, according to NASA. So I think I'm going to give it to you, Vito.
Both, right.
Okay, I'm going to give it to you.
And it's, right. it's 10 if you include the sun. Just
yes. Yes. Well, okay. Well, yes. Get the petition.
And it's 11 if you include the hairy ball.
The hairy ball, that's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. That's
it. Exactly. A lot of people overlook it, but it's tough to do sometimes.
They don't overlook it, Chuck. They actually want to ignore it.
Yeah, yeah. Right. I was going to say.
It's so
yeah.
true.
So what do we got? What do we got up
Fake
there?
News.
Mm-hmm. We got 1, 2, 3, 4. We got 1, 2, 3. We got some strategy going here. So, Devin,
Devin, I don't know what the strategy is, but the wise money is always choose the black dude.
Really?
I agree with Gary there, but I also think that there's a good chance that Al's the secret square, the secret cube there.
Yeah,
I mean,
the mystery cube, Steve. The mystery cube.
Yeah, the mystery cube's going on.
So, who do you want, Devin? Andy,
I'm going to go with Steve. I'm going to agree with Steve and just try. Let's try the big money.
Andy?
I can't see the board right this. Is it Andy?
Andy is the yes. Andy's
I'm just looking at Steve's
very,
beautiful face.
Very
there
famous.
It is. Andy. Andy.
Okay.
Very, very.
Right. Andy Lerner.
Sorry, Gary.
Andy Lerner.
Famous.
Man.
The famous Man, Gary's, Andy Lerner. Like
Gary's sitting there thinking to myself, Jesus Christ, I woke up for this.
You know what I'm just realizing, though?
Yeah.
Andy might be more of a black guy than I am.
Really?
Went with Lerner.
Really?
Many people
I don't know.
Say that, Gary.
That's a compliment.
By the way, Bruce, I just recast you from Legally Blonde to Legally Gray to Legally Black. I got to get some black action going here. This is bullshit.
I identify with that.
Thank you, brother.
Okay.
Here's my friend.
There's so many jokes and I'm not going to tell.
Was there a question?
Andy Lerner. Andy Lerner, big time photographer, yes. casting director, producer of radio ads, TV commercials, big time director of films.
I'm all of that.
And, but you do a lot of underwater photography, Andy.
That's
so
true.
I'm going to ask you this true or false question. Mm-hmm. Are sharks older than trees?
Older than trees.
So I'll say sharks are older than trees. True or false?
Well, you know, Gary knows this about me. I, as a hobby, I card a lot of sharks. And from the driver's right, Gary? Am I
oh,
wrong?
Yeah, yeah. I've literally never been out anywhere with you where you didn't pull over some shark, frisk him down, and check his ID. I've never seen that day. That didn't happen.
Very few people know that they carry driver's licenses.
Yeah, I didn't.
But you're probably talking in an evolutionary sense.
Yes, sharks. Yes. Not West Side Story sharks. I mean, real sharks.
The other thing is, Gary often calls me older than dirt.
OTD. OTD.
Yeah. Hmm. I would say that's not, I mean, trees, for God's sakes, trees have been here. Yeah, I'd say false to what you said.
False? You're saying trees are older than sharks?
Yeah.
Okay, he says trees are older than sharks, so he says false. Do you agree or disagree, Vito?
Nope.
Oh, it's Vito, right?
Nope.
It's not Vito.
Oh, I'm sorry,
I'll take
Devin.
It, though.
I'm sorry, Devin.
Either Devin or Vito.
Devin, I'm sorry.
I think I agree because, you know, with trees and oxygen and all that jazz.
That is not true. Sharks are older than trees. It's true.
Dang
that
it.
So Devin, you don't prove that. Well, I'm a born liar.
Okay, Vito, we can't give that one to you. You have to earn that on your own for the game. Do you want to go with, Vito?
Oh, boy. Well, I mean, for the game, I guess I have to go with
Gary.
But what about the secret square?
Gary, I recognize that you've been ignored, and I apologize about that.
That's okay, man. That's okay. I tried to help Devin. I reached out my hand all the way to...
No, Gary, yeah. I was wrong.
That's right.
All right.
Okay.
Okay, Andy, I'm going to ask you another question.
Yeah, you ask Andy, but I'll answer it. You go ahead and ask Andy, but I'll answer it for him. Don't worry.
Known liar Andy. Go ahead.
So Andy, again, it's
where's Gary? You will be my puppet.
You're a wildlife photographer and all. Do snails have teeth?
Did he pick Gary?
Andy, do snails have teeth?
Oh. Well, this is funny. Gary actually knows this about me as well, that
Jesus.
I often talk to him about the softness of their tongues because I've been
emotionally with a snail,
emotionally close to several snails.
Okay.
And
close.
But they like that's weird, right?
Do snails have
what kind of crowd do you have here, Bill? I'm trying to be, you know, honest, have a moment here.
Sure. No, I understand.
Oh, yeah. Yes, they have teeth, and sometimes they bite.
Okay. Who is it? Vito, right? Vito?
Yes.
Vito, he says yes, they have teeth, and sometimes they bite.
Well, I've never owned a snail, and I've never been bitten by a snail. But I'm going to say that I agree. They do have teeth. Yes.
You are correct. Snails do have teeth, and you have won the game. There we go.
Yes.
You owe me a dollar.
Holy mackerel. So you got $2.50
hugs to everybody.
There.
That's true.
Okay. All right. We're gonna go on to round two. Right after this. Oh, no. Allie, get away from Shane. Get away from Shane now. What are you
Allie's
doing there?
Allie's got so little to do.
We're gonna go to round two right after this commercial break.
Round two.
Right? Do we have a commercial break? I thought we did the.
Well, are you hosting a different show?
Oh, hey, look at there's the live studio audience. I thought we did the Patreon thing. Don't we do the Patreon thing? Get the Patreon thing out.
It's Friday night and Shane doesn't care.
There you go. Are we doing it or not? Or do I go to round two? Okay, wait a second.
If you would like to support all the crap we do here at Crap TV, check out
it's
our
like watching
launched
from
Patreon
Coda.
Page. At Patreon,
the guy, the strategy
secret
in that
behind
camera.
The scenes studio camera, where you can watch and interact directly with us.
You can't talk, guys. You can't talk,
show.
Guys.
Go
don't
to the
talk.
Website for more information. That's www.craptv.online. Patreon.
Okay, that went well. Well, Andy and Steve yelling over the whole goddamn video.
So it's my
actors to shut up.
Oh. Okay, we're going on to round two here.
Oh, round two is it, Bill? Just so you know, I've got a plane to catch Tuesday morning. So
okay,
I just told round get you two there. Isn't as racist as round one.
It was. Okay. It was. But you know what, though? To be honest, Andy, Black History Month's over. I had my time. I had my chance, and I didn't make the best of it. So
you were in the secret square. You were in the
Gary,
secret
yeah,
square.
You were in the secret square.
That's what
but
I said.
We still have a chance. We still have a chance
point
to get
taken,
to the.
Gary.
And it's not. And Steve, it's not a square. It's a cube. It's a cube, Steve.
Cube.
Okay.
Well, no. I have a two-dimensional. To me, it's a rectangle. Actually, it is. You're correct. It is not a square.
Yep.
It's a rectangle.
I apologize.
It's absolutely not a cube, though.
Okay. Whatever you say, plan. Steve. Let's move on to round two. Who won? What is that?
A square.
What the hell is that for? I can't read all that. Okay. All right. So who won? Vito, you won. Vito, you won.
Greg's
you
checking
won, right?
some mathematical.
Yeah.
Okay, Vito won. So we go over to Devin. Devin, you get to choose first this time. Who would you like to go with?
You know who I'm choosing first. Well, I can't not choose Gary.
It better be Gary, right?
Well done, Devin. Okay. Wow.
The worst starts with Gary. Because
Gary Anthony Williams, ladies and gentlemen, star of Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Yep.
And all the other big shows that he's been on. What are you doing these days, Gary? What are
just
you doing these days?
Dude, real.
Oh, hey, and you're the Mystery Cube.
Yeah, yeah. I'm doing real slow walks around the neighborhood now.
Okay, but I didn't hear the noise, but you're the Mystery Cube, too.
Yeah.
So she gets a chance. She gets a chance to win the Mystery Cube here. So here we go, Gary.
I'm not going to let this white woman down.
Okay. What does she get, Bill? Bill, what does she get?
Bill, what does she get? She might get one of the...
Bill, if our contestant picks the Mystery Cube, they'll also be playing for a mugshot voice of a Dr. Blobbity Blob coffee mug. Ooh. This mug not only holds coffee, but it holds all kinds of liquids. You can drink any of those liquids, including coffee, from the voice of a Dr. Blobbity Blob coffee mug. Hold it in your hand or
that's
sit
beautiful.
In between sips. You'll always remember a hot cup of Joe with your
when you go so far as to stick your hand inside the microwave to spin that Lazy Susan, then you know things are okay.
Right. Remember, Devin, you have to come. You have to pick it up. Devin, you have to pick that up.
I know. I got to start walking now.
There's the commercial. I was trying to speed things along here a little, but let's show the commercial. Okay. All right, Gary, are you ready, sir?
I'm very ready, yeah.
All right, Gary, when ants, I'm sure you're an expert on this.
I am. Go ahead.
Gary, when ants go to war,
do
they often engage in chemical warfare?
First of all, Bill, very insulted that you laughed at me about being an expert on ants.
Oh, I wasn't laughing, sir. I wasn't laughing at you. I was laughing with
you.
Very
insulted that you didn't laugh then. I'm going to be insulted either way. I don't care which way.
No, that's
down.
Fine. That's fine.
Do us proud.
I do know a lot about ants, Bill. There's an ant called the honeypot ant that stores a lot of food in its system, and the other ants steal it to feed their tribe. I know a lot about ants. I've just written a book about ants, and that is not a lie.
I did not
so
know
your
that.
Question, and I'm trying to speed this up because we all have places to be. When ants go to war, do they engage in chemical warfare? Just the short and simple of it is absolutely yes. Ants communicate through pheromones and chemicals. 100% yes. Devin, I wouldn't like, as shoulder sisters, bare shoulder sisters, I would not lie to you on that.
Devin, do you agree or disagree?
Oh, Gary.
Devin, look into my eye.
I'm looking straight through those glasses, Hanny.
Yes.
All right, fine. If you do me wrong, I'm telling you right now.
If I do you wrong, you can have all the reparations.
I agree.
You can have all my reparations back if I do you wrong.
He did not do you wrong. That is correct. They do have, let's see, what does it say here? According to somebody, intense chemicals that make in their body causes intense fear when it is sprayed at their victim. So that is true, and you have earned the kiss.
Yes. Nice. Thank you, Gary.
You're welcome, Debbie's.
All right,
Gary,
Vito.
I just ordered
Vito.
Your book
Vito.
On
Vito.
Ants
hey.
On Amazon.
Hey,
bro.
Hey.
Right? What, Shane?
I just ordered that book on ants, too.
Dude, you're going to love it. It comes with live ants. But if they're free, there are free range ants.
Free range.
It's called Gary.
Good. That's good.
Me.
Yeah, Gary. Thank you, Bruce.
I hate the caged ants.
I'm not even kidding. Ants are a crucial plot point to Solar, so I feel like we should collaborate.
Wait, Jenny, are we gonna bring everything back to Solar?
Yes, we are. It's coming out on the 29th, everybody.
Because literally, I was hoping we would.
Okay, Vito,
yes,
for God's
yes,
sakes,
I'm here.
Vito, pick somebody. For God's sakes, pick somebody.
Okay, I'm going to go with Kyle.
Kyle Holmes.
Yes.
My boy, Kyle Holmes.
Let's go.
Baseball aficionado. And hey, Kyle, here's a numbers question for you. Ooh. Kyle, what number do you get? You ready? What number do you get when you multiply all the numbers on a telephone keypad?
If I see you chatting with Greg, I'm going to call foul.
I don't need to tap into the boy's genius for this one. You know, the math side of this, uh-huh, I totally can do on my own. Okay. But it is lucky that being born in 1985, mm-hmm, I know what a phone keypad is.
That's true.
Which is, you know, it's kind of coincidental. You know, I'm like the last generation of knowing what a phone keypad is.
Okay.
Otherwise, we would have all had to ask Siri what was going to happen, because that's how I make phone calls now.
Change it to a rotary phone.
There we go. Everybody knows that no matter how many combinations of numbers you have, if you're multiplying throughout all of them, if zero is involved, the answer will ultimately be zero.
Wow.
And much like blood was drunk in the Cubs bullpen, or not bullpen, dugout that night, I am 100%
sure. Blood-like.
I am 100% sure that this answer is correct. And John Lester will back me up.
Vito, he says zero. Do you agree?
I am staring for any clue at Greg's face right now, and I'm not getting anything. So I am going to say that is true.
True, you're correct. Zero, any number multiplied by zero will always equal zero. So you get the hug there. Get the little hug there.
May I ask just a question to Jenny?
Oh, Jesus.
Jenny,
okay,
Jenny,
ahead.
Is there a keypad? Is there a number keypad in the cellular thing?
I will say that they're trying to contact Earth, so they might be using a phone.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I love it, girl. I love it.
They actually negated the effects of the solar flare by multiplying the whole thing by zero and then nothing. Okay.
Spoilers, Kyle. Spoilers.
Okay, Devin.
Yes.
For God's sakes, yes. Devin, pick somebody. It's your turn.
Oh, my gosh. I will go with Steve.
Steve Rudnick, ladies and gentlemen, in the center cube. Big time comedian Steve Rudnick.
Don't let me down.
All right. The answer is it was the Beatles.
No, Steve.
Bill.
No, Steve. I didn't ask. No, I didn't ask the question yet, Steve.
Oh,
wait.
Okay.
Wait till I ask the question. Steve, is it true that someone tried to sell New Zealand on eBay? Is that true?
Someone tried to sell it. Yeah.
New Zealand.
Yeah, that's probably true, because that's people try and do things, and people are stupid enough to fall for them.
Okay.
You know,
I'm sitting right here, Steve.
Well, you're one of the guys. I happen to own a large portion of Walden Pond, so don't worry about that.
Okay.
But that's I have the documentation right here.
No, Steve, we don't need to see. No, we don't need to see the Walden Pond contract. No, please, no? Steve. Yeah. So you're saying it's true that somebody did try to sell New Zealand on eBay.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. And I'll bet people bid on it.
Devin, do you agree or disagree? He says it's true.
I mean, like, with the stupidity of the human race, I would feel like that could be something that happened.
So what do you say?
I'm going to say it's true.
You are correct. It is true. Someone did try to sell New Zealand on eBay. So
I might be the oldest person here. Never underestimate the general stupidity of the human race.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Never.
All right. So
you will win every time.
We got some strategy going on. Vito, who do you want to go with?
I got to go with Bruce for the block on this one.
Bruce Thomas, ladies and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
Big time video game guy, mm-hmm, blah, blah, blah. Okay, Bruce, well here done. We go. This is a long one, okay? Now, you play Master Chef in the Halo series, right? Master Chef? Master Chief. Okay, well, we have this question for you. Here you go. How many minutes per pound is it recommended to cook a beef chuck roast at 350 degrees for it to be fall apart tender? Now I know that you're the mocap actor for Master Chief, but I always confuse it with Master Chef. Okay.
Oh, I get the meat. Okay. So, because I wondered how we got from Legally Blonde to meat.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, what this guy does with the pot roast, everybody. I'm telling you.
Right.
How many minutes per pound?
Yeah, how many minutes per pound is it recommended to cook a beef chuck roast at 350 degrees for it to be fall apart tender?
Well, usually, when you apply heat to meat, it tends to get firmer.
Careful, careful, Bruce. Careful.
Ow!
Where is he going with this?
But
the hotter you get, the firmer I get.
But the fact is, when you cook a what is it, a roast?
A beef chuck roast.
A chuck roast. Oh, not sorry, Chuck.
No problem.
It tends to take about 25 to 45 minutes for it to really get tender, and that's the way I like it. So that's my answer.
Okay, he says 25 to 45 minutes.
Depending on how you
degrees.
Like your meat.
Vito, do you agree or disagree with that?
I don't think he knows what he's talking about. I'm sorry. Sorry, Bruce. I disagree with it wholeheartedly.
You are incorrect. Oh, most beef roasts take 25 minutes per pound. However, if you want it to be fall off the meat tender, the bone tender, 45 minutes. So he is correct, and you are incorrect. I'm telling you, he's the master chef. You know, you're not fucking with the master chef.
Okay. Now I know that they call him the master chef.
So now, let's see. Devin, you cannot win that outright. You have to earn that that cube.
Yeah.
Who would you like to go with?
I'm going back to Bruce.
You're going back to Bruce. Bruce.
Back to work.
Bruce Thomas. Okay. Don't let her down, Bruce. Okay.
I'm trying not to.
Bruce, you're in the video game Call of Duty, correct?
Yeah, that's another one, sure.
Okay, great. You're a big-time video game guy. Okay, Call of Duty was first released in what year, Bruce?
Oh, well, they're very prolific, as we all know. They produce one a year for forever. So I think their first one came out in 1865.
Wow, yeah. I didn't realize that. It was just after the Civil War.
It was just after the Civil War. People didn't know if there was going to be another one or not, so they didn't want to jump right into playing the game.
You know, you would have thought they would have released the Civil War.
Well, it's coming. It's the
okay.
It's a,
no. Okay. What's your real answer there, Bruce?
No,
that was the real answer.
Call of Duty came out in 2003, and it was first introduced. Nobody knows this. Well, apparently, besides me, it was only released for Microsoft Windows. It's 2003.
Really? Okay. 2000. He says 2003. It was released in 2003. Devin, do you agree or disagree?
I absolutely agree with that.
And that is absolutely correct. So you absolutely
win
the game, right?
Wow.
And that ties things up. So we got to go one more round.
The tiebreaker round.
The tiebreaker round. Here we go. Let's try.
Remember when we were talking about this afternoon? We hoped it was a tiebreaker round.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm glad we could deliver.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
So Vito, welcome.
Bill, I got to upgrade this. This is better than Ali. This is like the Lincoln Douglas debates.
Wow.
This is fantastic.
You're going back to the Civil War era. Is that
yes.
it? Okay. All right. Let's try to get through this one. Shane's little bear is
not having it.
He's not happy.
Not having it.
All right. So Devin, you won that. So Vito, you get to go first.
All right.
Who do you want to go with? We'll get to.
I'm actually going to pull the same idea, and I'm going to start with Gary.
Smart move.
All right, Gary. Anthony Williams, ladies and gentlemen.
Seriously,
no one wants to be called a racist tonight.
Not tonight, you know. Not tonight.
When you pick Gary, it's a winning round.
When Gary's gone, we're all racist as hell.
All right, Gary. Real quick, here we go, Gary. Who played Godot in the Broadway production with Sir Ian McKellen and Sir Patrick Stewart?
First of all, I take offense once again. It is actually pronounced Godot because it was like waiting for God. That was a thing. But that's okay.
That's okay. Who played Godot in the Broadway production with Sir Ian McKellen and Sir Patrick Stewart?
Thank you, and I'm going to make it quick. And I know why now, Devin. You're going to see why he asked me this, because it was an African American actor. It was LeVar Burton.
LeVar Burton, LeVar Burton. Do you agree or disagree?
You said LeVar, I said LeVar, but I am here to make love, not war, my friend.
Hey, I'm the white guy. I'm the white guy. I'm going to say it the way I say it in Chicago, okay?
No, yeah, you got to do you. You got to do you.
He says LeVar Burton. Do you agree or disagree?
I said LeVar Burton.
Yeah. I will agree with that.
That is incorrect. No one. Cadell never appears into play. Okay? That was a trick question for you, though. So
I apologize, but I wanted Devin.
So Devin gets the kiss on that one.
I get the kiss?
Yeah, you get it. Who do you want to go with, Devin?
Oh my gosh, I want to go with Chuck.
Chuck.
Who doesn't?
Chuck Klausmeier, ladies and gentlemen.
Hashtag
Chuck
just Klausmeier. Mm-hmm. Hello.
Chuck. We have another statistics question for you. Okay.
Oh, fantastic.
Of all humans that have ever lived, what percentage of them are alive today? 7%, 26%, or 41%? Of all humans that are alive today, what percentage of them?
Stuff,
I'm sorry.
Chuck,
of all humans that have ever lived, what percentage
of all humans that have ever lived, many are alive today?
Exactly. 7%, 26%, or 41%.
Wow.
One of these answers is actually correct.
One of these answers
is going to be 40% if this keeps going.
I don't understand that.
Loving watching Greg's face.
While you're thinking, this is not a good question for someone who's as high as I am right now.
I'm glad I didn't pick you.
Okay.
I mean, I think it's much lower, so I would go with whatever the lowest one is.
So what was the lowest 7%? 7%?
Yeah, that's the lowest one, sure.
All right. Okay, so Devin, he says 7%. Do you agree or disagree?
All the people that have ever lived.
Yes.
Ever lived.
Right?
That's so true. So it's like, I agree.
You agree. You are correct. You are correct. 7%. There you go. Wow. According to somebody that we looked up on Google. All right.
That
so,
is stuck. Thank you.
So
7%. Vito, is Greg a crazy
Greg
high number.
Come on, Vito.
That's what I say. That seems like too much.
Okay, but guys, you forget haven't been around long.
It's over. Vito, who do you go with?
I have to go with Allie.
You have to go with Allie.
Who else
exactly.
is there?
For Allie for the block. Allie Dixon, here we go. True or false, Allie? According to PlanB.com, animals that roamed the earth during the Stone Age include woolly mammoths, and woolly rhinos. You're in that prehistoric.
Although I found a woolly mammoth right here. They're still around, actually. It's not just roaming. True or false that a woolly mammoth,
animals
woolly rhino.
Animals that roam the earth during the Stone Age include woolly mammoths and woolly rhinos. True or false?
True or false. I ain't never heard of a woolly rhino. I say false.
Okay, she says false. Vito, do you agree or disagree?
I'm going to agree. I think she's got a good thing going there.
You would be wrong. They did include woolly mammoths and woolly rhinos, so you do get that. And
sorry, dude.
What have we got?
It's okay.
There, Shane?
It's okay.
I would have been with you, Alan.
You can't.
I never heard
of you. You have to earn that. You have to earn that one for the win. So you want to go with young Allie?
Allie.
Okay,
yeah,
here we
sure.
go, Allie.
Come on, Allie.
Okay.
But don't forget, if Allie's never heard of it, it just doesn't exist.
Yes.
Right. I grind up their horns every day.
Okay. Come on, Allie. I'm sending you the good juju from
miles
away.
Let's not bring Jews into this. Jesus.
Okay, all right. Let's not get political here. Allie, you're a voice actress, correct? Voiceover actress.
Yes.
Correct?
So they tell me.
Allie, in the voiceover world, what does AVO stand for? AVO.
Interesting. Interesting.
Allie.
Interesting. In my first instinct is asshole voiceover.
Wow.
based I would agree
on
with that.
The community.
You've seen my casting sheet.
That's why I get all those scripts.
Yes, all of the above is the answer. D, all of the above. But I know stuff, and as much as I hate it, Bill Holmes taught me stuff, and the answer is announcer voiceover.
announcer voiceover. Do you agree or disagree with that, Devin, for the game?
I'm gonna go with the resume. I'm gonna go with what her knowledge, and I'm gonna really put my faith in you right now, and I'm gonna say
don't
that.
Do it, Allie.
Because I don't know.
Well, I didn't hear what you said. Do you agree or disagree?
It's true. I think it's true.
It is true, and you win the game, Devin. It's true.
Whoa,
Vito, take a walk, pal.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Oh, that's congratulations. Right. You win $5.
I just want to let everyone know there is an...
Oh, what? She went... What happened?
We lost her, but she said there is another something, but we lost her.
Okay, well, we don't care.
She went full Kristen Bell.
We don't care.
Can I just say...
Jenny, come to mind.
Okay,
I'm
so
back.
Vito...
I'm back.
Vito, I'm sorry.
What did you say?
I'm sorry you didn't win this time around. I apologize. But Shane, do we have? Oh, we got all the older.
Oh, sorry,
that's good
Vito.
Enough. Hey, I want something.
Sorry about that.
I want
Devin,
something.
Devin, you do win. You do win. What do we have for Devin, Shane? Do we have something for Devin? I don't know if we have something. Do we have something? Hey, oh, there we go. Oh, lots of kinetic energy.
Wow, look at
right.
that.
Look at that.
Wow.
Okay, Devin.
That's more impressive.
So, Devin,
the solar flare.
Devin, you have the most cash, so you are the winner of the $50 grand prize check from Scott Holmes Cabinetry in Antioch, Illinois. Congratulations, and thank you, Vito, for playing the game. And that's all the time we have for tonight, and it was a lot of fucking time, everybody. So, Bill, take us out of here. Tonight's episode was unofficially sponsored by Fortaleza, the best goddamn tequila I've ever had. Just remember, folks, if the tequila tried to kill you, then I bet you didn't get you some of that sweet and tasty nectar that we know as Fortaleza. Would you like to appear on a future episode of North Hollywood Cubes? Simply send a self-addressed stamped envelope to the address listed on your screen, or send us a direct message at any of our previously listed social media accounts. This is Bill Holmes speaking for North Hollywood Cubes. Back to you, Bill. Hey, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. On behalf of all the stars here on North Hollywood Cubes and Fortaleza, we say goodnight, everybody. Thank you so much. Thank you, stars. Bye-bye.